Hey guys, so I'm here to continue pulling out quotes and reading and responding to 12 Years a Slave. We begin in this video with chapter 9. I'm going to skip a bunch of parts here and pull out this quote here. I think it's like the third page of chapter 9. Suffice it to say, during the whole long day, I came not to the conclusion, even once, that the southern slave, fed, clothed, whipped, and protected by his master, is happier than the free colored citizen of the north. To that conclusion, I have never since arrived. There are many, however, even in northern states, benevolent and well-disposed men who will pronounce my opinion erroneous and gravely proceed to substantiate the assertion with an argument. Alas, they have never drank, as I have, from the bitter cup of slavery. So, Solomon Northup's conclusion from having suffered slavery and all his, and 12 years of it, actually. So not all his life, but 12 years of it. His conclusion is, there's not a single day in slavery where he thought to be a slave is better than to be a free man. No matter how well-fed, clothed, or protected by his master, a freed man, being a free man is better than being a slave, or happier to be, is happier to be a free man. I thought that was a pretty interesting conclusion. And the right one, I would agree. Even though I've never experienced slavery, I would assume it's much happier to be a free man than a slave, where you actually, no matter how much, you know, uncertainty you experience as a free. This reminds me of the movie Gandhi, you know, where he makes that quote. He makes that statement about kind of India. You know, it is better to be with under British protection, being a British colony. There's so much kind of things that the British does, you know, there's railroads and all these things that Britain provides for India. And Gandhi kind of responds to it by saying, it is better to be a free nation than any of the things that we can attain by being a colony of the British. So freedom means so much. And Solomon Northup's point here is that, you know, it's better to own, it's better to be free. Than any of the protections or food or clothing that slavery can possibly provide a man. Next quote. Oh, how heavily the weight of slavery pressed upon me then. I must toil day after day, endure abuse and taunts and scoffs, sleep on the hard ground, live on the coarsest fare, and not only this, but live the slave of a blood-seeking wretch, of whom I must stand henceforth in continued fear and dread. Why had I not died in my young years, before God had given me children to love and live for? What unhappiness and suffering and sorrow it would have prevented. I sighed for liberty, but the bondman's chain was round me and could not be shaken off. I could only gaze wistfully towards north and think of the thousands of miles that stretch between me and the soil of freedom, over which a black free man may not pass. Next quote. More than once I heard it said that Platt Ford, now Platt Tibbetts, a slave man's changes with this change of master, was a devil of a nigger. Next quote, and this is coming from Tibbet. You are the nigger, he said to me on my arrival. You're the nigger that flogged your master, eh? You're the nigger that kicks and holds carpenter Tibbets by the leg and wallops him, are ye? I'd like to see you hold me by the leg, I should. You're a important character. You're a great nigger. Very remarkable nigger, ain't you? I lash you. I take the tantrums out of you. Just take hold of my leg, if you please. None of your pranks here, my boy. Remember that. Now go to work, you kicking rascal. Concluded Peter Tanner, unable to suppress a half-comical grin at his own wit and sarcasm. So, Solomon Northup survives. He doesn't get the death punishment for beating the crap out of his master, which at the time is punishable by death for a slave. He survives that and gets sold to a different slave master, but the news spreads around. And of course, that itself is a problem, because now the slave master knows that Solomon Northup is a slave who beat his slave master. So Solomon Northup is not going to have the happiest time under Peter Tanner. It's interesting. I don't know why I highlighted this, but apparently I highlighted a part that says, the first Sunday after my coming to the plantation, he called them together and began to read the 12th chapter of Luke. When he came to the 47th verse, he looked deliberately around him and continued, and that servant which knew his Lord's will, here he paused, looking around more deliberately than before, and again proceeded, which knew his Lord's will, and prepared not himself, here was another pause, prepared not himself, neither did according to his will, shall be beaten with many stripes. Oh, I remember now why I had this part. So, biblical justification of beating and whipping slaves is something that white Southerners often did, slave masters and not slave masters also, but white people in the South used the Bible a lot to justify slavery, and there are verses in the Bible that can be used to justify slavery. There's no doubt about that. Chapter 10. I remember the words of Chapin, his precautions, his advice to beware, lest in some unsuspecting moment he might injure me. They were always in my mind, so that I lived in the most uneasy state of apprehension and fear. One eye was on my work, the other on my master. I determined to give him no cause of offense, to work still more diligently if possible than I had done, to bear whatever abuse he might heap upon me, save bodily injury, humbly and patiently, hoping thereon to soften, in some degree, his manner towards me, until the blessed time might come when I should be delivered from his clutches. So, Solomon Northup is at a very heightened sense of fear and doing the best that he can to appease his slave master because of the fact that he beat his previous slave master. Next quote, I had endeavored to do exactly as he directed, but nothing would satisfy the unreasonable man. So no matter what Solomon Northup did, Peter Tanner was not satisfied. Next quote, I reasoned with myself. If I stood still, my doom was certain. If I fled, 10 chances to 1, the hatchet, flying from his hand with 2 deadly and unerring aim, would strike me in the back. So this is another instance where Peter Tanner is like ready to kill Solomon Northup. And he has his hatchet, he's going to throw it at him. So Solomon Northup is like, do I dodge that? Or do I take it as a slave should? There was one course to take. Springing towards him with all my power and meeting him full halfway, before he could bring down the blow, with one hand I caught his uplifted arm, with the other seized him by the throat. We stood looking at each other in the eyes. In his I could see murder. I felt as if I had a serpent by the neck, watching the slightest relaxation of my gripe to coil itself around my body, crushing it and stinging it to death. I thought to scream aloud, trusting that some ear might catch the sound. But Chapin was away. The hands were in the field. There was no living soul in sight or hearing. The good genius, which thus far through life had saved me from the hands of violence, at that moment suggested the lucky thought. With a vigorous and sudden kick that brought him on one knee with a groan, I released my hold upon his throat, snatched the hatchet, and cast it beyond reach. So Solomon Order fights back. Solomon is a very strong man, very talented man, so he's able to kind of fend off this guy who's trying to kill him with a hatchet. He kicks him and takes the hatchet away, so that he kind of dodges that situation. But the situation gets more tricky. Let's read on. There have been hours in my unhappy life, many of them, when the contemplation of death as the end of earthly sorrow, of the grave as a resting place for the tired and worn-out body, has been pleasant to dwell upon. But such contemplations vanish in the hour of peril. No man, in his full strength, can stand undismayed in the presence of the King of Terrors. Life is dear to every living thing. The worm that crawls upon the ground will struggle for it. At that moment, it was dear to me, enslaved and treated as I was. This is a moment of danger, and, you know, he's just like, there are moments in my life where I, you know, the thought of death, that was a pleasing thought, but this is an hour of danger. And at that moment, your instinct kicks in, and the instinct is to live, to want to live. Next quote, I dared not murder him, and I dared not let him live. This is quite a dilemma. If I killed him, my life must pay the forfeit. If he lived, my life would only satisfy his vengeance. A voice within whispered me to fly, to be a wanderer among the swamps, a fugitive and a vagabond in the face of the earth, was preferable to the life that I was leading. So, you know, I don't remember if I quote this yet, but eventually Solomon Northup is going to flee. He's going to end up running away from this. And like being a fugitive for good amount of time, about a week, I think. Anyway, let's continue. The next quote. The dogs used in the Bay of Wolf for hunting slaves are a kind of bloodhound, but a far more savage breed than is found in northern states. They will attack a Negro at their master's bidding and cling to him as a common bulldog will cling to a four-footed animal. The animals in the South are trained to kill a fugitive black man. That's insane. I think that's pretty crazy. That Southern white people will train their dogs to do this. Next quote. I never knew a slave escaping with his life from Bay of Boaz. One reason is they are not allowed to learn the art of swimming and are incapable of crossing the most inconsiderable stream. So slaves are not allowed to read. They're not allowed to, you know, learn to read. They can't, they don't know how to swim. So they're really confined within this realm. Fortunately for Solomon Northup, he knows how to swim already because he had been a free man for a long time. I think I'll stop there for this video and continue on with middle of chapter 10 in the next video.